it's just powerful. But as we get started, I assume, you know, I was listening to Brother Lynn on a CD, and it just something he said that really just blessed me. You know, you see all types and shadows throughout the old covenant pointing to the new covenant. And he just made a statement. What was the first piece of furniture in the tabernacle of Moses? The Ark of the Covenant. And that was saying that God, that was God's presence to man. It wasn't the laver. It wasn't the altar. It wasn't us coming to him. He came to us. Amen. The other stuff came later. And I do believe that one of the greatest enemies sometimes of growth is what we think we know. Amen. I will say, get into that in a minute, but I got a few blonde jokes I need to get out of the way. Very important part of the service. These are, my brother Rick sent these to me, so if you don't like them, blame him. I'll just give you a couple of them. Second, two blondes are walking down the street. One notices a compact, that's that little fold-up mirror on the sidewalk, and leans down to pick it up. She opens it and looks in the mirror and says, this person looks familiar. The second blonde says, here, let me see. So the first blonde hands her the compact. The second blonde looks in the mirror and says, you dummy, it's me. Anyhow, maybe I'll give you one more. I thought it was cute. let me think here. Returning home from work, a blonde was shocked to find her house ransacked and burglarized. She telephoned the police at once and reported the crime. The police dispatcher broadcast the call on the radio, and a canine unit patrolling nearby was the first to respond. As the canine officer approached the house with his dog on a leash, the blonde ran out on the porch, shuddered at the sight of the cop and his dog, and then sat down on the steps. Putting her face in her hands, she moaned, I come home to find all my possessions stolen. I call the police for help, and what do? They send me a blind policeman. Praise the Lord and glory. Can I have 1 Corinthians 8:1? I want to just start on this, and I've got tons of things I want to say, and just boy, there's literally sometimes there's so much that you don't know how to go, and because there's just so many things. There's so the river's so full of life, and the river's in me, and it's in you if you're born again. Like I said earlier, I shared this with a couple people. When you think you know something and you've exhausted a particular facet of his goodness, then you don't really grow anymore. You don't, because you already know. But I find the biggest thing that I say, that's probably one of the most powerful things I say, is the importance of allowing yourself to be teachable. And that means you have to reserve the right to be wrong. You have to reserve, say, man, I don't know this. And one of the areas that the Lord's been dealing with me about is just understanding how important it is to praise the Lord. I plan on being in the book of Revelation today. I plan on doing some things. But I understand it now from a new covenant perspective. Amen. It's becoming who I am rather than something I do, even though I do praise. Are you hearing me? I'm getting ahead of myself. Let me just share this. The last part now is touching things offered unto idols. We know that we all have knowledge, but here's what I'm after. Knowledge puffs up, but charity edifies. Not one more verse. And if any man think that he knoweth anything, this is what's powerful. He knoweth nothing yet as he ought to know. Now that's powerful. If I think I know something, I don't know it as I ought to know it. Do you know Jesus is altogether lovely? Did you know that? Now we say that, but do you know that it takes a revelation from the Holy Spirit of God to realize how altogether lovely he is. You know why people don't hunger for God? Christians, I'm talking about believers, born again people. Let me show you this verse, Psalm 34, verse 8. Watch this. We're showing you the answer. And that there's only one reason that I as a believer would not want more of him, even though I have them all. Does that make any sense? I mean, to understand more of who I have. Am I saying it right? Watch this. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. You know, most of the time, people don't believe the Lord is good. You know what I marvel about my Savior, my King? He just loves me. He loves me in spite of me. He loves me because I'm in his Son. He loves me even when I feel like I'm the biggest jerk on the planet. He still loves me. Wow. I just think that's so powerful. But see, the more I taste, the more I see that the Lord is good. And then I become, watch this, then I become, I become that blessed man that trusts in Him. You see that? And I like to say it like this. If you go to a good restaurant and the food is good, what do you do? You want to come back because you've tasted. Man, this is good. This is really good. And see, the more we understand how good He is, well, I'll tell you, this is what I'm trying to even say about praise and worship. It's a response to my understanding of how good He is. And you know, I'm trying to find words to say this right. We can literally create an environment, the environment that we were designed to live in, which is His presence. Did you know that? We can live in that environment. Isn't that exciting? Hallelujah. Do you know, I love this. We were all created by God to live in His presence. But if you take something out of its correct environment, it will die. If you uproot a plant from its environment, which is the soil, what happens to the plant? It dies. If you take a fish out of water, what happens to the fish? I've said this before. Death is nothing more than the absence of the presence of God. That's what death is. Now, we all have the presence, and He'll never leave us nor forsake us. But you know, you can sensitize yourself to His presence. Hallelujah. Do you know you can realize His presence in your life? Do you know, I love this, it's impossible for me to praise the Lord and still continue to fight with my wife. Come here, Jen. We're having a fight. We're not really. I did not. That's usually my answer. I love you, Lord. Just try doing that and continue arguing with your spouse or vice versa. Isn't that powerful? You can fill your life with His presence. You know what I love? The only reason we're frustrated is we don't understand that He's with us. When you just tell your mind, listen, I'm going to focus on His ever-abiding presence. That's responding to who He is. I'm going to focus on His goodness. You know, sometimes we don't understand the difference between the position we have in Christ, which is all that He did for us, and our response to the position, or like what we call the power. Kenyon called it the legal side of redemption and the vital side. But we have everything in Him. But how I respond is faith. If you're dealing with an ailment in your body, this is prophetic. If you got something, I'm telling you, just begin to praise the Lord constantly. Just begin to thank Him for who He is. You know, Thanksgiving, I say this all the time. For those that are hearing, you have ears to hear here, I say this all the time. Thanksgiving is based on a belief that you already have something. Amen. So true thanksgiving is believing that I've already got it. I got this microphone. Thank you for this microphone. Thank you for this microphone. I have it. But if I don't have it, I don't believe I have it, well, I'm not going to be thankful. You know why Christians operate with unthankful lifestyles? They don't believe they have it. They don't believe they have Him. They don't believe they have everything. When you believe you have everything, thank you, Lord. Amen. Praise you, Lord. Glorify you, Lord. Man, I'm so thankful. Just, you can sing, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess or unsavedness, but be filled with the Spirit, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Singing and making melody in your hearts to the Lord. Giving thanks always for all things. You know, it's so simple. You know, sometimes we get so deep. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I'm excited, as you can tell. And I'm going to try to get into some of those things. You didn't think I'd get to the book of Revelation this week. You're wrong. Because I can't help it. It's just so good. Amen. And the Lord, I felt, gave me some basic things. I call this message... That was all introduction. I call this message the key to see. Jesus said, John chapter 3, verse 3, watch this. When you taste, you see that the Lord is good, and you become the blessed man who trusted Him. Jesus answered, He's talking to Nicodemus, and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, or literally born from above, he won't go to heaven. That's not what it says. That's how we say it. That's not what it says. Now, I believe in being born again, and I believe in all the things, but this isn't what Jesus said to Nicodemus. He said, except you're born from above, you cannot see the kingdom of God. You can't see the goodness of God. You can't see. We went back to Psalm 34:8 when we said, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Then you become the blessed man who trusted him. Even understanding thanksgiving and praise and all those types of things is just understanding all that he did. See, sometimes we get the cart before the horse. Just like I told you about the tabernacle, how we focus on the altar. We focus on the laver. You must clean yourself up. All those types of things. We focus on the approach to God rather than his approach to us. Our approach to him rather than his approach to us. Think about this. The creator of the universe became a man. Hallelujah. Became like you and I, only without sin. So he could experience everything we experience and live perfectly and then give that perfect standing to you and I. Man, oh man. If that don't make you praise the Lord. See, praise is a response to what you believe you already have. Man, that was good. Now let me say, when I say praise and worship and thanksgiving, I'm using them interchangeably. Sometimes we get some, well, one means to twirl around, one means to clap your hands, and one means to... All the Hebrew words in the New Testament, by him therefore, Hebrews 13:15, through him therefore, Jesus, let us offer the sacrifice of praise. Who is the sacrifice of praise? Continually giving thanks unto his name. See, because if we think in the realm of a law mentality, then we make everything a law. We make it like, okay, man, I don't feel like it, but I just got to sacrifice because it says sacrifice. He's the sacrifice, man. Oh, glory. Hallelujah. See, I put so many laws on myself, sometimes it's insane. But I'm seeing it more and more. I said, man, it's so simple. He's with me. You can't lose. The only way you can lose is if you give your mouth to the enemy. You give the mouth to your feelings. Well, I don't feel it. You know what's killing the body of Christ? Feelings. Nothing more than feelings. You know, I'm all for good feelings, but let me tell you something. In his presence is fullness of joy. Feelings will come in line with what your spirit is, full of joy. But if you're trying to get your feelings in line without realizing what you have in him, you're up and down, you're in and out, you're over, you're under. You're under the circumstances instead of over. Amen. Well, anyhow, the key to see, first of all, understand this. The hearing ear. Proverbs 20, verse 12. The hearing ear and the seeing eye, the Lord has made both of them. This is the first point I want to make. You and I are born again, I believe. Everyone here is. If you're not, let's pray and you can accept Christ. I want to tell you something. You have the capacity to see and hear God. See, we make that hard too. Well, you know, that's only for the spiritual, the preachers. They hear God. A lot of them don't hear God. Amen? We all have the capacity to hear God. And it's not the 50 steps to how to hear God. Are you born again? If you're born again, except you be born again, you can't see the kingdom of God without being born again. But if you're born again, you can see the kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? Look at your neighbor and say, hello, kingdom of God. It's the rule of God. It's the rule of the kingdom. You're in the kingdom. Hallelujah. So that's the first thing we need to understand. And that's why Jesus would say stuff. And John says in Revelation chapter the seven churches, he that has an ear to hear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying unto the churches. So you have an ear. That's the important thing. But it's up to me whether I allow myself to hear. Amen. And that's why I say, don't think you know something about anything. That sounds simple, but that's heavy. I do. I catch myself. You know how many, like Paul said, let me be foolish a little bit, okay? Making a point. You know how many scriptures I can quote? I don't even know. I don't count them. But you know how, you know that could puff me up if I'm not careful? That could make me think, oh, I can put it. But you know what I find out? There's so many things. Man, somebody will say something like, man, that's good. That's so good. I just keep listening. I was telling some people, I started getting Kenyon's book on audiobooks. I've listened to the New Creation Realities. Just listening to a chapter at a time, I'm like, man, that's good. Who I am in Christ, glory to God. Just hearing it over and hearing, all of a sudden, I didn't know that. I didn't know. There's so many things I don't even know that I think I know. See, you notice? I think I know. If you think you know anything, it didn't say you didn't know anything. It just says you don't know it as you ought. Hear the difference? What is as you ought? It's progressive revelation. On and on. You'll never exhaust God, and neither will I. He's altogether lovely. He's constantly revealing his loveliness to us if we allow ourselves to hear and see. Amen. He loves you so much. So the key to see, I'm going to talk about a few things. It's important that we understand what we subject ourselves. Naomi was up here and she said something really good. Not everybody's hearing what we're hearing in the body of Christ. Do you know I don't have any right to be frustrated and depressed? If I know what he's done. I didn't say I didn't have anything that tries to get on you. It does. But what does he say about you? Well, what's the antidote? I love you, Lord. I did not. It doesn't work good. You know what I'm saying? And I lift my... What if I'm going through it? Paul's back was bloodied in prison, and he was still leading a Philippian jailer to Christ. Think about that. I was just preaching. We played hands. The guy got healed, and now they threw us in prison, and they beat us. He wasn't saying that. He was proclaiming what Christ has done. Amen. Wow. You know, that's the same thing that's in us. We've obtained that same like precious faith. He's in us. Oh, glory. It just makes me want to praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I'm so blessed and highly favored. I'm in Christ. I'm accepted in the beloved. Hallelujah. What words do you say? Just share your heart.
Well, you got to say, I love you, Lord, 20 times and spin around 3 times.
No, you don't. Just share, man, it doesn't have, oh, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Singing to yourselves in psalms and hymns. Man, glory to God. Look what I, wow, that was a powerful truth I got today. Did you see, man, the Lord showed me this. It was so good. I like, for something, example, was in that audio book that Kenyon said something so simple and powerful, but it blessed me. He said, every time you see the word flesh, you can just insert the word senses, the Greek word sarx. Those that are led of the senses experience death. To be carnally minded is death. All the miseries that arise from separation from God, both here and hereafter, the Amplified Bible says. Romans 8:6. That's what death is. See, even though I have the presence of God, I can operate and not know I have the presence of God or refuse to let the presence of God take over. Do you know that everything in his presence, Psalm 16:11, in his presence is not partialness of joy, fullness of joy. See, once again, here's another problem. We make praise and worship just about the praise worship service. That's fine. But you know, just throughout your day, man, just praising God. And praying in the Spirit will help you there. But even if you don't, just praise him. Just thank him. Just glorify him. Just, you know, count your blessings. Why are you saying this? Because it's prophetic. We think we're beyond that. We're not. I told my wife and I, we were talking, I go, we love the Lord, we talk about the Lord all the time, but we've both come to the conclusion we're not very thankful many times. We whine a lot. Don't look at me in that tone of voice. There's nothing to whine about. We're so blessed, we can't hardly stand it. And so are you. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Praise you, Lord. Abba, Father, I belong to you. I'm a child of the King, and so are you. I know I'm hammering on it, but I believe the Lord really wants me to say this. Because I'm going to show you something out of the book of Revelation, And I'm going to show you how you and I step into our correct environment. You know, that fish, when he's in the water, he functions real well. Did you know that? Do you know that? You know the reason every people are messed up? They operate outside the presence of God, whether saints or sinners. Amen. They operate, your only habitat, where you were created to function is in his presence. He's always with you. He'll never leave you nor forsake you. But I can operate out here, number one, either not realize it, not know it, or number two, just refuse to allow his presence to saturate my circumstance. See, in Acts, I believe it's chapter 3, around verse 19 or something. I'll just take that. Acts, I think it's 3:19. If it's not, we'll go with 3:16. But we think it's 3:19. Nope, 3:16. Nope, 4:19. Or 4:13. Ah, thank you, Jesus. 4:13. It's in there somewhere. Yes. Now, when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled that they took knowledge of them, that they had been with Jesus physically. But you know, we have even better than that, and they did too at this point because the Holy Spirit was in them. Are people taking knowledge of Chris, that he's been with Jesus, that he's fellowshipping with him? Let me show you the key to unity. Look at 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 10. Watch this. God, this is life-changing. My word, if you get a hold of this, this is life-changing. All that life and that power that's in you begins to manifest outwardly. Lift up your voice. Lift up the hands that hang down. Hallelujah. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all speak the same thing. Ooh, I know what we need to do. We need to have a pastor's breakfast and get all the pastors in town that talk about unity together and all the pastors in the whole area that talk about unity, and we'll eat breakfast together. Then we'll have unity, right? That you all speak the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. You know the word judgment actually means opinion? That's impossible. You're right. In the flesh, it's impossible. Back up one verse, verse 9. Here's the key to that. God is faithful, by whom you were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ the Lord. Now go to verse 10. Now. You see that? See the connection? Now, based on my fellowship with him, now I'm in a position to operate that way. Isn't that powerful? Hallelujah, glory to God. So the key to see, number one is that, first of all, understand that you have the capacity to see. Understand that you, here again, Jesus said, I think it's in Matthew 10, verses 24 and 25, that the disciple is not above his teacher. In other words, here's your teacher. Is it me? No. It's the Holy Spirit. Okay? Now, God uses men and women to point you to that relationship. But ultimately, you, the teacher, is within you. Amen. The anointing teaches you of all things, it says in 1 John 2:27. The anointing. That's why you can sit under good teaching and still not hear it. Or you can sit under teaching and hear it. There's a difference. But really, it's up to me. That's why when he says, In the book of Revelation, it talks about the revelation of Jesus Christ, and it says the time is at hand. It actually says the time, or literally the throttle, according to Strong's, is in your hand. Isn't that amazing? In other words, the more you see Jesus, the more you realize, and you get to the end of the book, like I said, the Spirit and the Bride, and anyone that's hearing will say, come. You can come now. You can come to him. Isn't that powerful? I sit there and I think sometimes, I marvel at his love for me. The more I'm seeing it, the more I'm thinking, well, he really loves me. I mean, it's almost like he's wild about me or something. He is. He's wild about you too. He puts you in his son. He's as wild about you as he is his son, Jesus, because you're in him. When he sees you, he doesn't see you separate from Christ. He sees you in Christ. That's why the Bible says in Ephesians 1:6, you are accepted, literally highly favored in the beloved. Not favored, highly favored. Now, there's something to praise the Lord about.
Oh, I already know that, Chris. I'd be on that. I've heard the greatest message. I'd be on that. I'll give you something deep.
You don't get any deeper than this. This is deep, baby. Amen. Boy, can you imagine? That's what Paul prayed, that you'd be able to comprehend the breadth, the length, the depth, and height, to know the love of Christ, which passes finite human knowledge. Wow. Now, unto him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all you ask or think, according to this power or the revelation of his love for me that works in us. Wow. Now, see it again? See the connection? Now. It's like Revelation chapter 21, verse 1. The New King James says, now I saw. See, you can't see when you, many times when you've got a mixture mentality. We're going to talk about that here. Now we'll get to the book of Revelation. Are you ready? I wrote this, the key to see, number one, realize you can see. You can hear. And I'm using seeing and hearing. I'm talking about spiritually speaking. You can see and hear. But the number one key, first of all, understand this. God brought you out to bring you in. Deuteronomy 6:23. God brought you out of Egypt, if you will, out of the situation. Now he wants to bring you into intimacy with him. Hear that? See, some people think, well, God just saved me, and I'm saved and stuck. No, God saved you to bring you into intimacy. See, every cry of every human heart is for intimacy with the Lord. Every cry. Guaranteed. Guaranteed. I don't care what it is, what people are doing. You know, you ever wonder about some of these politicians and stuff? How much money do you need? How much power? Not just, how much is enough? Guess what? The Bible says the eyes of man are never satisfied. Ecclesiastes says, he that loves silver shall not be satisfied with silver, nor he that loves abundance with increase. This is also vanity. In other words, it's never enough. Amen? But in Christ, it's always enough. He's more than enough. If you have Jesus, you have everything. Now, I'm going to say this. The only reason I don't praise him is because I don't understand who I have. You know, you got all afternoon to walk around the houses. You're getting your soda pop or whatever you're getting. And all of a sudden, man, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus, for all that you've done for me. Man, I'm excited you're in me. I'm in you. I can't even mess up above your grace. I can't do it. Your grace is greater than even my mess. If you even take bad situations, Lord, and you turn them around for my good. Thank you, Jesus. I praise you, Lord. Glorify you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. This is one of the most powerful prophetic messages I've ever heard. God's talking to you through a garden hose. You know, when you drink from the garden hose, you get a taste of the garden hose. Just drink the water. Hallelujah. I can't get off it. I'm trying. But the first key to see is, number one, the fall of Babylon. This is what I'm trying to say with praise and worship. You need to understand that you don't, praise is not just something you do, it's who you are. Are you hearing that? Which will cause you to praise the Lord. See, I used to, people would say, well, you need to praise the Lord, you need to worship the Lord. And I think, okay, I love you, Jesus. I love you, I'm praising the Lord. They said, I need to praise the Lord. I love you, Jesus. 2 minutes. I love you, Jesus. Now it's my life. I can't help it. Hallelujah. It's hard not to take the wheels off of your vehicle and just praise the Lord. Do you have to lift your hands? No, it's in your heart, but sometimes you want to lift your hands because you're so excited. See, it affects your emotions. It affects your feelings. It starts getting into your soul. It'll get into your environment. You think, my word, this is good news. Look out. See, demons hate that. They're afraid of that. See, that's why they want you to grab everything as a law you keep rather than the life that keeps you. They want you to grab everything, even praising the Lord. Let me show you this. Psalms chapter 8, verse 2. God, this is so good. Psalm 8, verse 2. Look at this. And then we'll look at, out of the mouths of babes and sucklings hast thou ordained strength. Now, he's talking about innocence. He's ordained strength. Who needs strength? What does the Bible say in Ephesians 6? Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. In other words, realize, one Greek expositor says, everybody say realize, God's muscles are backing you up. I ride a bike too. Only mine's got a baby seat on the back. Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings, hast thou ordained strength? Look at this. Because of thine enemies. Do we have enemies? No. that thou mightest still the enemy and the avenger. Now look how Jesus quoted this in Matthew 21, 16. Watch this. Jesus does not quote it like this. Look at this. Matthew 21, 16. And he saith unto him, hearest thou what these say? This is when the triumphal procession. And Jesus saith unto them, yea, have you never read out of Psalm chapter 8, verse 2? Out of the mouths of babes and sucklings, total innocence. Watch this. Thou hast perfected praise. Completed praise. Completed praise. That's what that means. Restored praise. Completed praise. That's the ordained strength that stills the enemy and the avenger right there. You as a new covenant believer. Now I'll go to John chapter 4, verse 14, I think. Maybe verse 10, but we'll try 14. John chapter 4, verse 14. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him. In him, say in him.
In him.
A well of water springing up into everlasting life. That's abundant life. That's not saying, see, we think everlasting life just starts when you die. No, it starts right now. It's been started. But it's springing up in you. Now jump down to about verse 22. He's talking to a Samaritan woman. There's all kinds of revelation right there. But we won't go there. You worship, he's saying, you know, she was saying to him, where should we worship geographically? You know, people do this all the time. I do it. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord? I like to say, isn't it good to be the house of the Lord?
Amen.
Hebrews 3:6. Isn't it good to be the temple of the Holy Ghost? Thank God for a building, but the building's a tool. You're the house of the Lord. Hallelujah. See, if we think God just lives here, then we leave and he stays here. No, he's with you. He's in you. Christ in you, the hope of glory. You just realize it. Man, lift up the hands that hang down. Praise the Lord. Look at him. I can't quit smiling. I'm so happy. And I tell you what, I have my moments just like everybody else, but I'm realizing, Chris, lift up your voice. You know that, I want to go somewhere else, but I got to finish this. You worship, you know not what, Jesus speaking to the Samaritan woman. We know the Jews, what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. It came through the Jews. Next verse. Through Jesus was Jewish. Next verse, verse 23. But the hour cometh. I got a lot to say on the hour. But the hour cometh, and it now is. I'm here. When the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. Next verse. God is a spirit, or literally in the Greek it's God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Now think about that. What does that all entail? What does it mean to worship him in spirit? See, under the old covenant, they couldn't do this because they didn't have a recreated spirit like you and I do. If you're born again, you do this. What is truth? Jesus is truth. By him, through him, therefore let us offer the sacrifice. That's him. What is worship? It's presenting Jesus. It's declaring all that Christ has done. It's being thankful for everything that he's done. And how does that happen? By trying to be thankful or by focusing on what he's done. By focusing on what he's done and what he is in you, then you're automatically thankful. You cannot praise the Lord and not change.
Amen.
It's impossible. What do you mean by change? That who you are, the completed change, begins to manifest outwardly. It's impossible. You know why people are down? 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 10. I'll show you. Well, it's 9 and 10. We'll do 9 and 10. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 9. Did I say what I said? They're thinking whole chapters. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them tempted also tempted under the old covenant, and were destroyed of serpents. Next verse. Neither murmur ye. You know what murmuring is? Praise to the devil. That's what it is. You say, I don't have nothing to praise the Lord about. Are you born again? You got everything to praise the Lord about. You don't have nothing to not praise the Lord about. When you start praising him in the midst of the situation, guess what happens? The situation changes. The ordained strength is released through the perfected praise, and it stills the enemy and the avenger. This is why I tell people, Satan's so defeated. He's terrified that you'll find it out. He does not want you to find out his defeat. Yes, we're going to get to the book of Revelation. by faith. I want to show you something that's going to totally relate to this point. You'll see it in a minute. Neither murmur ye as some of them also murmured, and were destroyed of the destroyer. Why? Death and life are in the power of the tongue. Why do you think on the day of Pentecost, when the Holy Spirit came like a laid-back, rushing, mighty... No, like a rushing, mighty wind. Why do you think he went for the mouth? Hallelujah. Glory to God. You may be going through whatever, but I'm telling you, he went through way more than you and I. It says, consider him in Hebrews chapter 12, lest you be faint and weary in your mind. You have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. Praise the Lord. I just want to worship him. Walking around the house. Oh, glory to God. Jen, pick that up. Hallelujah. I see the husband's taking notes. I'm kidding. Really? No. Anyhow, when you see the fall of Babylon, this is a big key. Now, what is Babylon? It's a rebuilt city in Iraq? No. A rebuilt city anywhere else? No. Babylon is nothing, and some of you have been here, you've heard me say this. The word means mixture, and it means confusion. What is the mixture? It's mixing the two covenants together. It's the Galatian, that's what the Galatian heresy was. That's why he says to the church of Laodicea, I wish you were hot or cold, but because you're lukewarm, I will spew you out of my mouth. What does that mean? See, I was like, well, if you're really hot for God, well, you're really tearing it up. But if you're cold, that don't seem like it would be. But man, if you're lukewarm, at least you're doing something, right? Wrong. What is hot or cold? I wish you were hot, all grace, new covenant, or cold, all law, because then you could see your need for Jesus. But because you're under mixture, lukewarm. Hear the difference? Let him in his ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. See, it's powerful when you understand. See, that's what the whole Babylonian thing is. I want to just tell you this up front. In Revelation, which is the revelation of Jesus Christ, it's not Revelation, but in chapter 17 and 18, it talks about the fall of a city called Babylon. And then you get to chapter 19, and it talks about a marriage feast. Everybody say a feast. Now, the marriage feast is not in the future. The marriage feast is right now. And something the Lord showed me this week, he says, blessed are those who are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. Not with the Lamb. Oh, it's with the Lamb, all right. But it's of the Lamb. What does that mean? You're partaking of all that Jesus did. He is the Passover Lamb. That's why in Exodus chapter 12, they had to eat the whole lamb. Roasted with fire, Jesus Christ and him crucified. Everything, even the entrails, the pertinence thereof. In other words, we need all of him. Hallelujah. But see, you really can't come to that feast in your understanding until you see the fall of Babylon. And here again, I'm going to show you something. I told you this a long time ago. That's my country voice. Whenever I have country music on, it's my... These kids know I do this. I'll pick up my piano.
I'm a cowboy.
Stop! I can't help it. I can. I just don't want to help it. Okay, go to Revelation chapter 18. We'll start with verse 1. I want to just show you a couple things here. I'm going to show you the first four verses. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. Next verse. And he cried mightily with a strong voice. Now, an angel in Scripture, in the book of Revelation, there are celestial angels, but in the book of Revelation, from chapters 2 and 3, the seven churches, angelos, angel, means a messenger. Almost all theologians believe that the seven churches, the angel unto Ephesus, the end of the angel, is the pastor, the presiding elder, whatever. Almost everyone that I've ever read believes that. So if taking that consistency throughout the book, the 22 chapters of Revelation, this person is crying, saying, this is what we're doing. We're saying to you, Babylon has fallen. This religious mixed up system has fallen. That's what we're declaring. Amen. Babylon has fallen. Come out. He says that in verse 4. Come out of her, my people. Come out of her, this mixed up religious system, my people. Come out. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon has fallen. Is fallen and has become the habitation, watch this, of devils. Now, this is where people get this debate. Can a Christian have a demon? No. Can a Christian live in a habitation of devils? Absolutely. You know what the antidote is? Get in your correct environment. I love you, Lord. You first loved me. I glorify you, Jesus. I thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord of glory. You can't stay there. You continue to hear the new covenant. See, Babylon the Great is fallen. She is fallen. Not going to fall. She is. She is fallen and has become a habitation of devils and a hold of every foul spirit and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. The Bible says in Proverbs, I believe it's 26 verse 2, that the curse causeless shall not come. And it says, as a bird by flying, as the swallow by wandering, so the curse causeless shall not come. There is no curse in your life. But you know, Christians can operate under a curse if they don't know who they are. Even though there's no curse in their life. Jesus forever took care of it. Boy, I tell you what, I just want to praise the Lord. Watch this. And I'm an unclean and hateful bird, flying thoughts. We could hammer this. I'm going to take it down to verse 4, and I'm going to come back up here. For all nations, you want to know the problem with the world? Right there, Babylon, the mixed up religious system. That's the problem. If people could see Jesus, he's irresistible. You can't help but want Jesus if you see him. If the world saw Jesus, they would run to him. But they're not seeing that. They're seeing the debate over this and the debate over that. And they're seeing all this craziness that has nothing to do with Christ. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Isn't it interesting? You can drink this wine. I call it blind wine. Or you can drink, be not drunk with wine where it is excess, but be being filled, present, passive voice, imperative mood. Be constantly filled with the Spirit. Here it is again. Singing to yourselves in psalms, hymn. I don't care if you can sing, ding, 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 I praise the Lord, whatever you want to do. Doesn't matter. Just be you. You know, God's not interested in you being someone else. He's just interested in you being you. How he made you. Just love him. Just lift up your voice. Raise up your hands. Just whatever. Respond to what he's done. Just respond to what he's done. By him, therefore. Through him, therefore. We offer the sacrifice. He is the sacrifice. We declare what he's done. Praise unto God. Continually. How? All the time. It's not like, well, I stopped. I'm so condemned. Now you're missing the point. You know where we malfunction is when we function in our own understanding. All of us do that to some degree. This is just understanding what he's done. I've been telling you, he wants you to live in this bubble where, the world just, I didn't realize Greenville just blew up. Huh, that's weird. I wondered why everything was leveled. I was just in the zone, man. I'm just worshiping the Lord. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. It's not talking about physical fornication. It's talking about unfaithful to one's marriage vows, spiritually speaking. See, when you try to relate to God based on your own merit, it's called adultery. Spiritual adultery. That's why it says, by him, through him, we offer that sacrifice, which is he's the sacrifice. It's not, well, I don't feel like it, but I just got to sacrifice. No, that's what I used to think. See, I'm still coming out messed up. That's what Babylon is. It's a mixed up, messed up religious mindset. Well, I'm doing this to somehow merit something from God. No. Watch this. All nations drunk of the wine of wrath for fornication. The kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich. Ooh. Through the abundance of her delicacy. In other words, there's benefit to this city. In the natural. That's what grieves me when we make prosperity just about material things. That's not prosperity. A lot of people got material things and they're as poor as you can be. I believe in financial prosperity, but that's not a sign that you're with God. If that's the case, then Bill Gates is really tearing it up. And I pray for him. I don't know where you know anything about him. But my point is, it has nothing to do with the things you possess. Nothing. We've westernized the gospel. And we've made it fit our culture. So now people come for what have you done for me? What have you done? Me, me, me. See, when you lose your life in him, but see, does he care about those things? Absolutely. Will he bless those things? He already has. Amen? So I believe in that. But if you make that the thing, you miss the main, you know, you miss it. It starts within and manifests outwardly. Here again, I believe, I have to clarify, I believe in financial blessing. I believe in that totally, but not the way we've preached it. Next verse. And I heard another voice from heaven. Now, why is it from heaven? Does that mean you're just, here again, we're thinking in natural. Remember, Jesus said, well, where should we worship? In this mountain or in Jerusalem? He's saying, no, you're missing it. It's not about this mountain or physical Jerusalem. It isn't about that. So when we hear another voice from heaven, it's saying this is someone that's declaring from heaven's perspective. That's you, that's me. Are you hearing? Saying, come out of her. That's what I'm saying today. Come out of her, my people. That you be not partakers of her sins and that you receive not of her plagues. There's a judgment on a system. Come out. God's not judging people. It's on the system. If you're in the system, you get the judgment, and it isn't for you or me. Now, I'm just about, I got 45 minutes, and then we'll be done. Back to verse 2. Oh, this is good. I want to read this. I love this. This is from The Wonderful Name of Jesus by E.W. Kenyon. I thought this was amazing. Look at this. He talks about Babylon is a habitation of devils and a hole of every foul spirit, the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Listen to this. In my own ministry, I have found a great deal of trouble that perhaps every preacher or evangelist finds with certain types of people who are always trying and never seeming to get settled in God. Now listen, this is amazing. They are always standing up for prayers but never seem to get any further. Another class really seemed to get the light but were held by some unseen powers. These people naturally caused me a great deal of trouble. I wonder how I could help them. And one day I was strangely led beyond myself to command that unseen power broken over a person whom it was holding. I prayed in the name of Jesus. I cried in the name of Jesus. I command your power broken over this life. Instantly, the person was delivered, and I stood amazed at the effect. A strange fear came over me that I had never been able to exercise by this simple command in Jesus' name. This marvelous power, and since that time, I have seen many startling results in revival services through using the name of Jesus. I found that the reason many men did not accept Jesus as their Savior is because they were held by some by the power of demons. How many times have you seen in life where, man, I tell you what, I'm going to come to church, I'm going to get right, but for whatever reason they can't. We don't wrestle against flesh and blood. See, this is Babylon. This is the habitation. Watch this. The people are hungry. They want deliverance from sin. They crave eternal life, but they are unable, many of them, to break loose from the bonds that are holding them. Hundreds of people have said to me, I cannot become a Christian. I want to, but something holds me. I have simply laid my hands on their shoulder and said, in the name of Jesus of Nazareth, I command the power of that holds you broken. Now in his mighty name, get on your feet. With tears of joy, they have obeyed. I have prayed with men who were held by habits, liquor, lust, tobacco, whatever, in the same mighty name, and I have seen them delivered, usually instantaneously. Wow. I have found Christians who were unable to testify or lead in prayer in public meetings who felt their mouths closed while their hearts cried for liberty. I have scarcely met a case for whom I have prayed in the name and over them. I have commanded the power broken, but what they were, they have not had immediate deliverance. I thought that was amazing. See, can a Christian have a demon? No, but a Christian can remain in the habitation of demons. If you're born again, you're sealed. It cannot touch it, but we can allow certain things. And it's not like I used to think. It's, well, you know, you watched that commercial. It wasn't a very good commercial. It's not what it is. Okay? It's the mixed up system that thinks God loves you based on your merit and some of Jesus. Like we sing, just as I am, and people come just as they are, but after that, it's just as you better be. Amen? Now, what's the answer for this? And I'm going to close with this. Back to Matthew chapter 21, verse 16. I love this. I want to show it to you again. See if I have any other. There's so many of them. Matthew 21, verse 16. Look at this. And in 16:3, that's good. Matthew 21. But it says, this is the power. And from that time forth, Jesus began. No, Matthew 21:16. I can say the part, but I want you to see it. Matthew chapter 21 and verse 16. There we go. Hearest thou, and Jesus saith unto them, this is what I'm after. Yea, have you never read out of Psalms 8:2, out of the mouths of babes and sucklings, total innocence. And let me tell you something else. He's called El Shaddai. Do you know what El Shaddai means? The all-sufficient one, yes. But it also means the many-breasted one. It means that he is all supply. So babes and sucklings are constantly drawing their supply from him. Are you hearing? Are you hearing? Watch this. Yea, have you never read, out of the mouths of babes and sucklings, thou hast perfected praise. You know what perfected praise is? It's every time you and I, as a born-again child of God, lift up our voice, lift up and declare his goodness, and declare that, man, we love you, Lord, because you first loved us. We celebrate his love for us. Are you hearing? That'll pull you right out of that any habitation. See, that habitation is mixture. Mixture is the most deceptive. You mix the covenant so people can't see the reality of just its total Jesus. It's total Jesus. I'm telling you guys, there's things that would change in our circumstances if we would just stop whining and lift up our voice. See, when we murmur, we're giving Satan power. A defeated foe, completely defeated. The enemy's completely and totally obliterated. But he says, just murmur, just complain. Just give the death and life and the power of your tongue, just give it death. See, it says death and life. Deuteronomy 30:19, I set before you life and death. Therefore choose life, that both you and your seed you can declare, my children are blessed, and I thank you for what doesn't look like it. What does the word say? I don't know, look it up. Well, that's going to take effort. You got it. You got it. That's exactly right. See, this is the problem. Some people have got, they've taken grace and they say, well, God's going to do it. He's already done it. He's done everything. Oh, come on, God. Bless me. He already has. But you know, God gave them the promised land and they had to go take it.
Come on.
Hallelujah. Make room for the Holy Ghost. I didn't get there. But even when they made, in 2 Kings chapter 3, they made rooms. They had to dig ditches. And the Bible, and water came in. Three kings, Jehoshaphat and the king of Israel, the king of Edom, and the enemies were coming against them. I believe it was the Moabites. And they said, dig ditches. What's that? Make room for the Holy Ghost. The water came in, and guess what the enemy saw? They saw blood. But now watch this. So the enemy said, hey, we can take them. We'll go ahead and take them. And they came in, and Israel had to take them. See, God gave us the promised land. The promised land's a man. His name's Jesus. The promised land man. But you know, there's certain things we have to we need to receive it. Lift up your voice. Praise the Lord. Declare. There's nothing complicated about this. It's so simple. Just receive all that he's done. How do you receive the abundance of grace, the gift of righteousness? Then you reign in life by one Jesus Christ. In the Greek, it's present tense. You're constantly receiving. How do you receive it? Well, I don't mean to offend women, but I probably will. I'll offend men too, don't worry. Equal opportunity. But you know, this sharing of your feelings all the time, where your feelings are God, I mean, there's a place for it. I'm not saying you bottle things up, but I'm saying, what does Jesus say? What does Jesus say? Are you blessed? But you know what? Some people like to feel sorry for themselves. Let's call it what it is. I'm struggling. The more I see who I am in Christ, I'm having a hard time having a pity party. Real hard. Because every time I go to feel sorry for myself, my word, I'm blessed. As he is, so am I in this world. I lift up my hands, I begin to declare. See, you've got all afternoon to practice his presence. Just relax, watch your TV show, and just, man, I got to shut that off. I just want to declare how good he is. I'm just so in love with you. Do you have to? No. You don't have to do anything. But I'm saying you can come out of that habitation of devils and every unclean and hateful bird. Those are all the thoughts. You know, sometimes I get so tired of stuff. My wife and I talk, it's going to be fine. We're blessed. We're blessed. Open your mouth. It's easy to open our mouth when we whine. Let me tell you, I tell you what, so-and-so looked at me wrong. I don't know how you do it. I know. Hallelujah! Glory to God! I'll try to close with that. Look at this. I quoted it earlier, but I want to show it to you. Looking unto Jesus. The Greek, it means to look to and look away. How do you do that, Chris? It means you get a picture of Jesus. You know where he looks so depressed? No. It means to look away from all else. The author and the finisher of our faith. Who was the joy? I'm looking at the joy. You and I. That was set before him. He endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Next verse. For consider him that endured such contradictions of sinners against himself, lest you be faint and weary in your mind. Next verse. You have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. How do you consider him? Thank you, Jesus. Glory be to God. By his stripes I'm healed. Spirit, soul, and body. I'm one with him. Wait till we get into identification. There's a lot of spiritual identity theft being going on today. Did you know that? People's IDs are being totally taken from them. And everything that goes with what Christ has purchased has been stolen. Man, you're blessed. I'm not going to close this without a little practice. This is my spiritual love kick. I need it too. I tell my wife, I say, when you see me whining around and doing whatever, remind me. I won't get mad. I might at first.
I do, praise the Lord.
No, I won't. I don't. I really won't. I really won't, because I want that. Because, see, that's what we're here to do, is help each other. Iron sharpens iron. Help each other. Just look to Jesus. People say, well, I feel this way. If you change your focus, you'll change your feelings. Man, that's out of here. If you change your focus, you'll change your feelings. Consider him. Look unto him. He's not just the author of your faith. He's also the completer or the finisher of your faith. What are you going through? Father, I want to thank you that even in the midst of this situation, you're still my Lord and my King. I belong to you. And Lord, you take really good care of your kids. And I'm your child. And in the name of Jesus, I just want to thank you. And I want to praise you for it. I want to thank you that my name is in him. I'm in him. I'm in Christ. He's in me, the hope of glory. Man, I love you, Jesus, because you first love me. Just express your heart. Praise him. Praise him. And you'll raise him. Amen? Praise him. You'll raise him in your life, in your circumstances. You'll raise to the position that you're seated together with him in heavenly places in Christ. Lift up your voice. Praise him. Thank him. Worship him. You know what worship in the New Testament? Proskuneo, to kiss towards the sun. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Whew. I see people. I do praise the Lord. I can tell. See, when you can't praise the Lord and not smile. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I love you, Jesus. I love you, Lord. I love you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Oh, we're waiting till everything's perfect, and then we'll praise the Lord. Everything is perfect in Christ. Amen. He has perfected forever those that are sanctified. That's you. That's me. Hallelujah. I love what Andrew says. So what? He says, man, you believe God for your healing? He says, it's a win-win situation. You die, you go to be with the Lord. You receive your healing, you rub the devil's nose in it. You can't lose. You can't lose. You're a winner, not a wiener. Praise the Lord. Lift up your voice. Love him. He loves you. He's wild about you. Hallelujah. Imagine if you filled your house with praise and worship and just glorifying Jesus. What kind of environment would that be? No habitation of devils. No unclean or foul demons. None of that stuff could even stay there. See, we made it all about, well, you got to quit watching this, and you got to quit watching that, you got to do all this stuff. Don't even worry about that. Just praise him. Amen. Whatever he tells you to do, you go with that. Well, he told me to shoot someone. He did not. You don't even know the difference. Hallelujah. Got a lot more things to say. Praise the Lord. We worship you, Jesus. Just take a couple minutes. We thank you. We are done, but we're just going to praise the Lord. We thank you, Jesus. We glorify you. You are so worthy of all praise and honor. We're in you. Hallelujah. The glory that you've given it to us. You've put us in you. We just thank you for salvation. We thank you for redemption. We thank you for all that you've done. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What did Wigglesworth used to say? You can't doubt when you shout. Hallelujah. Sometimes we need to shout, blow the carbon out, man. Are you hearing me? I remember a man told a story about these police cars in a certain town. He said they hardly ever got on them. When this one police officer had to get on it, because they never got on them. Sometimes you got to blow the carbon out.
Yeah, amen.
Blow the carbon out. Hallelujah. God likes it loud. Does it have to be loud? No, but sometimes we need it loud. Thank you, Michael. Lift up your voice. Declare his goodness. He's in love with you. He's head over heels in love with you. Do you have to pray? You don't have to do anything. You get to. What an awesome privilege to be intimate with the King of Kings.
Amen.
I just love it. Hallelujah. I love being happy. How about you?
Amen.
It's a good thing. It's a good thing. Hallelujah. Go hug somebody. Tell them how awesome they are. Amen. Praise the Lord.